Hi, my name is Sean Sposito. I'm the Assistant Director for Content Strategy at the Christian Science Monitor, and welcome back to RSAC TV. With me, I have Anup Ghosh, the CEO and co-founder of Invincea. Congratulations on the acquisition.
Thanks, Sean.
Really exciting, man.
It is exciting. Really, really super excited. It's culmination of a long series of events that led to the news this past week. So we're super excited for the acquisition.
Yeah. So earlier we were talking about antivirus and how certain legacy approaches to endpoint protection just aren't necessarily working anymore.
Right.
And I'm just really interested to hear, you know, how you think the attack surface has sort of widened and how folks are trying to keep up.
Yeah, so when I started the company, I started under the premise that traditional antivirus was no longer working, right? The notion that you could only detect threats that you knew about wouldn't scale as the adversary continually developed new types of attacks. So went down the path of how do we develop non-signature-based defenses against an evolving threat? And it led us to approaches like isolation and ultimately to machine learning-based approaches for antivirus. And today, it's a really robust market in next-gen antivirus. So that's what led us down this path, and I'm really pleased in the Gartner Magic Quadrant. We were listed as a visionary. For the first time, we've made the Gartner Magic Quadrant. It really just shows that we've arrived.
I mean, that's really interesting because, you know, in security, things are dynamic, right? It's like this constantly shifting landscape. I mean, how exactly do you guys use, you know, AI or machine learning to kind of keep track of dynamic attackers?
Well, it's precisely because it is so dynamic that we need technologies like machine learning where it can generalize from threats that have been previously seen. So we spent 4 years on a DARPA-funded project called Cybergenome, developing both large-scale data architectures as well as machine learning algorithms. And ultimately, we settled on a type of machine learning called deep learning, which is very scalable and has extremely high efficacy, which means high rates of detections for previously unseen files with very low false positives.
I mean, did you take this project out of DARPA? Like, did you take the company out of DARPA? I mean, I know you were inside the government for a long time.
I spent 4 years at DARPA, largely on offensive security. But because of that experience, I understood how vulnerable we were. I like to say, as a US government, we were throwing stones from a glass house, right? And so when I left DARPA, I didn't spin the company out of DARPA, but I understood the threat space, and I understood that our defenses weren't up to snuff. So that's when I began a company to do research and development to develop non-signature-based approaches to our threats.
I mean, what kind of similar challenges is perhaps the government scene that you see all the time in the commercial space, right? That you see in the corporate space. I mean, are those challenges the same? And I mean, what are your customers? You have 25,000 customers.
Right.
I mean, like, what are they seeing?
Yeah, so it does depend on who you are, right? So in the federal space, they definitely get certain types of nation state actors that are going against them, right? So we saw it, for example, with the DNC hack, right? If you are a small mom and pop restaurant, you might be dealing with cybercrime, right? If you're a large financial services company, you'll be dealing with threats very similar to the federal space. And really, it's a super important question because what you have to understand is your threat, and you need to provision defenses according to your threat. So if you're provisioning a standard antivirus against a nation-state threat, well, you're going to be screwed, right?
For sure.
And if you're using antiquated technologies against ransomware, that's not going to work either. So our goal really is to put the best technology out in market to address the kinds of threats we see today.
I mean, can we talk about some of these more innovative approaches? I mean, like past just, you know, IDing signature malware, right? I mean, that's something that like traditionally AV companies have been really good at and still kind of block a lot of threats.
Sure.
I mean, the same malware that existed in 1999 still exists today. So I think it's still important to have a signature-based approach. But when you're talking about these more sophisticated adversaries, I mean, what are some of the tactics that you know, really sophisticated security executives are employing.
Yeah, so for a long time, people have been focused on malware, right?
Yes.
And you think of malware as a program that's an executable, right?
Yes.
The types of threats that we're seeing today oftentimes start with file-less attacks, which means these are in-memory attacks, typically scripted, uh-huh. either from a Word macro or from a browser that's then calling over to a command shell or PowerShell. All of these commands are running in memory without dropping a file.
Yeah.
So if you're not seeing that kind of attack because you're only focusing on executables, you're missing an extremely large attack surface.
Fileless malware is actually something that really fascinates me.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, let's spend some more time talking about that. I mean, mm-hmm. what's the prevalence of this code, this malicious code that just sits in memory and sort of you know, executes, right? I mean, it's
right.
What's the prevalence of it? What kind of defenders are seeing it?
There's not good hard data on it, primarily because there's not good sensors out there to tell you how prevalent it is. Our estimates are anywhere between 40 and 60% of all attacks begin with fileless malware. And typically the end result of fileless malware is a program that drops for persistence. Uh-huh. But by the time it's dropped that program for persistence, it's already infected your machine, it's already stolen data, it's begun to scan the network and jump over to other machines.
Have we seen a certain class of criminals beyond like sophisticated nation states using fileless malware?
Absolutely. I would say most of the cybercrime you see today begins as a spearfish, number one.
Of course.
With an attachment, it's typically a Word document.
Yes.
And from there, it's running scripts. And these scripts are calling PowerShell, which is now acting as the adversary on your network.
I mean, is there anything to learn out there? Like, if I am a large enterprise, or if I am a network defender,
right.
past really buying tools, like, is there anything that I can learn from this marketplace of criminals and how they're kind of sending out this fileless malware into the environment?
The one thing we do know is when you're standing still in this space, you're falling behind.
Yeah.
And that's because the adversary is motivated typically by money in the case of cybercrime, right? So they will constantly shift tactics to do just enough to get around your existing tools and technology. So if you're not learning more about the space, like you can at RSA conference,
yeah.
if you're not talking to your peers to understand what's going on, if you're not continually updating and upgrading your technology,
yeah.
you're falling behind, right? So, and the same on the vendor side. On the vendor side, we can't be a one-trick pony.
Yeah.
So while we talk a lot about machine learning, we recognize that covers one attack surface.
Yeah.
But we need other techniques such as isolation for spearfish threats and such as behavioral monitoring for fileless malware. And we're still continuing to innovate on our machine learning models for different types of attacks.
So in the same way that criminals reinvest into research and development, like
right.
maybe that's the big lesson here, right? Like, you know, if your attacker's investing in research and development, like you should as well.
You have to. You
absolutely,
absolutely have to. And invest in people, of course.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
What past tools? People are probably the most important thing.
Absolutely. I mean, think of it this way. A lot of people say, well, you've got tremendous federal
yeah.
resources you can spend on this problem if you look
yeah.
at their budget side. Well, it's also about leadership,
yeah.
right? So a lot of people say, hey, come to a conference, get training. That's important, but you know who really needs to understand this problem is leadership, right?
Exactly.
It's the board, right?
Yes.
It's the CEO,
yes.
the CFO. So those folks really need to learn about the space and then develop strategy and vision for defending their networks.
So it's less about a defense in depth strategy that just checks off boxes.
Right. I really think this strategy of saying, well, if we just patch everything
uh-huh.
and we just focus on the 10 top vulnerabilities, we'll be fine. And the problem with that checkbox mentality, like, can't we just patch?
Yeah, yeah.
Is that we haven't been able to for over a decade. We haven't succeeded in doing the basic blocking and tackling. And I think the lesson to take away from that, Sean, is if we haven't succeeded after a decade, I guarantee you we're not going to succeed in the next decade. And
yeah.
that's why we really need to rethink our strategy around security.
Yeah. Well, listen, Anup, tonight, Passcode and the Christian Science Monitor, and you guys were hosting Beat the Breach. Really excited. Former federal CISO Greg Tuhill is going to be there.
Absolutely.
Lisa Monaco is going to be there. What are you looking forward to most?
You know, it comes back to bringing smart people together. So this is an event where, you know, we actually had a rock concert last night. Tonight's event is more about bringing together the private sector with the public sector, the federal government. And I'll tell you, when you bring together really smart people and they get them talking about subjects that we all care about, amazing things can come from that. Collaborations, ideas, and that's what we really hope to facilitate is public-private discussions. Uh-huh. And Passcode's a great partner in facilitating those discussions. We've always had an amazing event, so we're super excited.
Anup, thanks so much, man. I really appreciate it,
brother. Thanks, Sean. Yeah.